Yeah, cool. All right, I'm here with my guest coach of the week, Professor Adam Jacques, Mat Shark BJJ. How's it going, man?
Pretty good, man. Pretty good. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, it's good. So tell us a little bit about yourself, Adam. Your journey, your start, and your transition into creating your own gym through Mat Shark.
From the very start, or?
We can go from the very start if you
very
want.
Very start? Yeah. All right, cool. So when I was like, I suppose, I don't know how old, super young.
Yeah.
I started finding out about judo through my dad who'd done judo. His older brother and younger brother both did judo as well.
Yeah.
And I kind of got exposed to martial arts that way.
Yeah.
And then from there, kind of just found my way into a bunch of different styles. I did like kickboxing, I did wrestling. I did a bunch of different stuff. Started out super young. Got exposed to judo through my dad. His brothers did judo as well.
Yeah.
Moved through to like kickboxing, wrestling, Shotokan karate, Japanese jiu-jitsu. I did Zendo Kai karate as well. And then got into more like sort of, I suppose more grappling, like back into judo a little bit and then into jiu-jitsu. So I started coming to Perth, I think it would have been like 2008 maybe, to John Will seminars. I used to live down south, like Bridgetown sort of area.
Yeah.
So I started coming up here to do like John Will seminars.
Yeah.
And then from there, just kind of started getting exposed to armor because my sister lives right near armor in Chilled Hill.
Yeah.
So I used to start like staying with her, coming in, going doing these seminars. And then 2009, I moved to Perth and then I started going up to armor and training with Metcalf.
Yeah. So how old were you around 2009?
What am I now? I'm 33 in June. It's terrible maths. Early 20s.
So you started your J in your early 20s.
I think it was like 20 or 21. That's kind of how I got started in jiu-jitsu. I was exposed to jiu-jitsu before that as well. Like I sort of came across some different jiu-jitsu people in that. And I'd roll with some people and I'd done obviously groundwork in wrestling and judo as well. So I was a little bit like I wouldn't say advanced at all, but I had exposure to it as a white belt. I was already vision and certain things.
Yeah.
If that makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah. So how long did you take, because you're a black belt now.
Yes. Yeah.
So how many years did that take for your first journey to black belt?
So this is my third year as a black belt.
Yeah.
So when did I go? Yeah. So I started it. Yeah. My actual start in jiu-jitsu properly with Metcalf was 2009.
Yeah.
And then I got it in 2018.
So did you start Mat Shark straight after you got the black belt?
No, I started Mat Shark on the tail end of my purple belt.
Right
to a brown belt. We actually started in Raw Fitness.
All right.
So I used to work for Raw Fitness.
Yeah.
So there was four of us. A guy named Con Maloney.
Yeah.
Kane Stone.
Yeah.
Myself and Ryan McCabe.
Yeah.
We used to all work together and live in the same house.
Yeah.
And we used to work for a company called Genesis Fitness.
I remember Genesis Fitness.
I used to manage a big gym in Bentley. I used to manage that gym.
Yeah, because I went to the Junlock branch of Genesis.
There you go,
And which is now what they did the last ADCC, Life Fitness or
I was a manager at Genesis Bentley and Kane was a manager at Genesis Kelmscott.
Yeah.
We always lived together, doing jiu-jitsu. And then I actually gave Kane his blue belt.
Yeah.
So then we all moved to Raw Fitness.
Yeah.
And then myself and Ryan started, Ryan McKay, we started, I suppose you could call it Mat Shark then, but it was called, it was just called Raw Jiu-Jitsu at the time.
Yeah.
We ended up moving on from there because it was kind of limited in the space we had and the times we could run because we were using the group fitness room.
Yeah.
So we ended up leaving there. We moved to a place really close, like a K away.
Yeah.
And then Kane ended up starting up RDA, which obviously now you would know is now at Bibra Lake. So that's kind of how all that sort of fit together.
Yeah,
so we started Mat Shark, I suppose, in 2016.
Yeah.
And then 2017, we moved location into where we are now.
Yeah. That's Janicol, is that right?
Bend. Yeah, Janicol. Yeah, yeah. So we've been there, I think, 3 or 4 years now. Yeah, and that was, I think I was a brown belt at that stage when we first moved there.
Yeah.
I was on brown for 2 years and then, to black. Yeah.
So that's really interesting. So you started really having your own little business and your own little school.
Yeah.
Was that purple belt level?
And a purple belt, yeah.
So what would you say to someone who's also, like, let's say, in their purple belt level, who's wanting to, you know, start their own school or own little, little project of teaching jiu-jitsu, but they feel, I'm more than just a purple belt, you know? What is your views of when it's the right time to start coaching?
Man, it's super subjective, I think, hey? Because, like, a lot of people suck at coaching as a generalization. Like, it's even black belts, a lot of them suck, you know what I mean? They just don't know how to coach. Yeah. And it's something you have to it's hard because you have to get experience in it.
Yeah.
But also you don't want to be delivering like just shit content as well.
Yeah.
So I would say be realistic with yourself and like assess your ability to coach.
Yeah.
And if you start coaching, try and do some classes under your current coach at your current gym.
Yeah.
And like develop skills that way.
Yeah.
The other thing that I should have done for sure is coach more kids classes.
Yeah.
That's the hardest to coach, right?
Yeah.
If you can do that well, you get a bunch of confidence, and then from there you can be confident that you're going to be able to deliver a good product.
Yeah.
And you won't have to like kind of do it on the fly. So yeah, I would say try and get experience, right? That's probably the main thing. But if you are already a good coach and people go out of their way to tell you that, then you're probably sweet, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But I'd say it's subjective, it depends. Like people sometimes think they're awesome and they suck, or they think they suck and they're awesome. It's just this is hard, you know?
Yeah.
So get an unbiased opinion, and also try and get experience wherever you can before you commit to like opening a full facility and all that.
Yeah.
Make sure it's what you want to do, because it sounds good, but some people, they love the idea of it, and the reality is very different.
Yeah. Yeah, because there's a lot of background stuff that happens as well.
Yeah.
Especially like getting the building, you know, just getting the name out there.
Yeah. Marketing, sales, building, like coaching other coaches how to coach. And just, you know, like I still work full time. Like you gotta learn how to pull these strings, and it's just spinning plates constantly. People just see like, oh, that guy's coaching jiu-jitsu, that's awesome. That's all they see, but behind the curtain, it's like any other job, right?
Yeah, a whole bunch of other stuff. Yeah,
it's a fun job, but it's a job.
Yeah, because you got a pretty full-on gig already. You're already working full-time.
Yes,
You're coaching full-time as well, but you're also training other disciplines, which is, for instance, your current journey with judo, as you were saying before.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about that journey with judo.
Yeah, so with judo, man, like I just started doing it again pretty much. I suppose it's a bit of a release from my current training, a bit of a hobby, because so much of what I do at the moment is just jiu-jitsu all the time, and I just get overwhelmed with the amount of coaching I kind of do. I don't think about it so much, but like what tends to happen is I just coach the same stuff over and over and over again, and then I'm drilling very specific stuff for competition.
Yeah.
And in general, I'm trying to like compete and do well, so I'm focusing on that stuff, and I don't actually get a release when I'm training anymore. So most guys probably know when they train, they kind of get that feeling afterwards, like, oh, I'm glad I did that, and they get relaxed from it, and they get like a tension release.
Yeah.
I don't get that in jiu-jitsu anymore. It's very like, it's very, it's all about business for me now. It's just like working hard, trying to get better, right?
Yeah.
Judo was supposed to be like a release, and then it started that way. It was really good, but then like just my competitive nature, I started wanting to do competitions and doing that kind of thing.
I saw the last, because I saw your video that you posted in your last judo tournament, and you actually looked pretty tired in that one.
Yeah.
Do you, like, I don't know about you, but do you think you get more, do you feel that you can roll pretty well in jiu-jitsu? Like, oh, yeah, I can do this, but when it comes to doing judo, you're like, oh, this, because
100%, man, it's so much harder. Like, I'm not as good at judo, so I'm not as efficient, right?
Yeah.
So guys can move me around, and it's a lot harder work.
Yeah.
Like, the state titles a couple of days ago, and that was some good guys, like 4th degree black belts, you know, they put you where they want you, man, like, so you gotta work hard to like not get thrown.
Yeah.
Whereas in jiu-jitsu, I could roll 2 hours, even if I'm unconditioned.
And you're fine.
I'll be sweet.
Well, but the minute you go to judo, you're like, oh my gosh.
And it's such a fast-paced sport, like you can't take a backward step, so like, the entire match is just go, go, go.
Yeah.
That's the biggest difference, I would say.
Yeah.
Whereas like, BJJ, I feel like you can slow it down if you want to.
I noticed how one of your videos you posted for Instagram, you were showing a particular judo throw. You were saying, this is how you would do it in jiu-jitsu. I mean, in judo.
Yeah.
Because we're doing jiu-jitsu, there's ways you can do this move and kind of like fast forward to make it applicable for jiu-jitsu.
So I'm all about that. Like, I coach a lot of takedowns in my gym.
Yeah.
And a judo black belt would see it and be like, what the hell are you doing?
Yeah.
But then like, it's designed to work against the stance, right? Because the jiu-jitsu stance is lower.
Yeah.
Because in judo, you can't attack the legs. You can't double leg someone, for example, right? So you don't have to worry about that. So in judo, you stand very upright. You do that in jiu-jitsu match, you get taken down straight away and put in your butt. So like, hip throws are harder to get in because you can't off balance the guy.
Yeah.
So the way I've just butchered judo to fit jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
Like, people often assume I'm a judo black belt because I do big throws in my comp, so they've seen me throw someone in training maybe. But I'm technically a novice in judo, but I've been able to adapt just from the knowledge of the human body through jiu-jitsu, adapt the throws to work for our sport and be effective with them.
So for first time viewers out there, what are the belts in judo?
Yep. So it starts at white, then it goes to yellow, orange, green, blue, brown, black.
Yeah. Do you reckon, because like I said, I don't know much about judo, and Liz is not know much of it. Is the progression from white to black similar progression like from jiu-jitsu? Do you know, say it takes about roughly about 10 years to get a black belt in jiu-jitsu?
It's faster
in judo.
It's faster. I would say a black belt in judo it's like a really good purple belt equivalent.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah. It's not like, you're not like a master when you get a black belt in judo.
Yeah.
It's kind of seen as like the proficiency level.
Yeah.
So it's kind of seen like you're, you know, okay, I guess.
Yeah.
And then from there, you kind of end up, I guess, getting like first degree, second degree, third degree.
Yeah.
And then I suppose around third degree in judo, that'd be equivalent to like a black belt in jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
It's a little bit out of whack, you know what I mean? Yeah.
So we're here with Adam at Amma Gym. We're just going to be talking about judo. So it's 7 p.m. over mat. So we're going to get some good mat time in. And I've got to ask Adam to show me some good judo throws. Butchered judo throws, as you might call it. But it's kind of pretty exciting. Adam does a great job of running his own school with Mat Shark at Jandakot. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
So tell us, what times are the, is the timetable there at the moment?
Yeah, best thing to do is jump on Instagram. Go to at Mat Shark BJJ. And the timetable's on there, but generally we have lunch class on Tuesday, Thursday.
Yeah.
And then we have our night classes 7:15 p.m. Monday to Thursday.
Yeah. So Adam does a great job running at Mat Shark. He's always around the competition scene. You'd always see him around, say hello. He's always got a good project up his sleeve. He did a real good
one. Yeah.
Yeah, he did a really good one a few months back with the mini gym storm with Raw. That was a really good success there. I think one of your videos went viral of you pushing over
Lorraine.
but yeah, Adam's a great guy. We're going to head into the gym now at Amma and do some roll time. So thanks for coming on the show, man.
Sick.
Awesome.
Easy, bro.
Adam Jacques, Mat Shark, BJJ. Take it away, Adam.
All right, we're going to have a look at a bit of a fake sort of Morotto CNR, and we're going to turn it into a Katagaruma. So it's like a sort of a turning, dropping throw. But then as they react to that, we're going to spin through and take them in a wheel throw over this way instead. So this works really well on jiu-jitsu guys, not so well on judo guys. On judo guys, you need a proper setup. This is going to be a completely butchered off-balancing that just works on jiu-jitsu guys really well. So instead of a proper kazushi off-balancing where I would do this, if I do this in jiu-jitsu, he's going to shoot on my leg straight away and take me down. So I can't really use that tactic. So what I'm going to do instead is I'm just going to hang out the washing. So I'm just going to throw him like this. Usually I can do this three times. But the third time, usually, they're resisting really hard to try and come back up. And that's going to allow me to swing under. So I'll do a slow one. So it starts here. I just hang him out a bunch of times. And I turn all my body language as if I'm going to try and throw him for CNR this way. And then as he resists that, I'm going to push this arm through under this space here and turn all the way under to my knees. Over the top. It's pretty hard to do slow, but when I do it fast, it'll make more sense. So I'll do it fast.
Your move of the week for Professor and Mat Shark. Thank you.
My hair in the dress that you wear.